with financial support from UGC and Government of Tamil Nadu, the first of its kind in South India. Let me humbly invite our Honorable Vice Chancellor officiating the initiative leader for this presidential address. Sir, please.
So, very good morning to all of you. Honorable Chancellor of the Central University of Tamil Nadu, Professor G. Padmanabhan, Padma Bhushan Professor G. Padmanabhan, distinguished speakers of today's Teachers' Day celebration, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Pondicherry University, Professor Gurmeet Singh, Honorable Vice Chancellor of the Central University of Kerala, Professor Venkateshwarulu, Deans of the Central University of Tamil Nadu, heads of the departments, officers, faculty members, staff, students, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Central University of Tamil Nadu, it is my pleasure as well as my privilege to extend a very warm welcome to each and every one of you. And I would like to convey our best wishes to the Vice Chancellor of the Central University of Kerala, Professor Venkateshwarulu, who took charge as the Vice Chancellor of Central University of Kerala, and we wish him all the best for a very successful tenure. In India, we observe September 5, the day teacher and President Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan was born. Let me very briefly give you the genesis of this celebration. When Dr. Radhakrishnan became president in 1962, he served as the President of India from 1962 to 1967. His students and friends wanted Dr. Radhakrishnan to celebrate his birthday. He was so humble in his nature. Dr. Radhakrishnan requested, instead of celebrating my birthday, it would be my proud privilege if September 5 is observed as Teachers' Day. Since then, his birthday has been observed as Teachers' Day. Dr. Radhakrishnan was not born with a silver spoon. He was born in a poor family in South India in 1888. And he became one of the most influential philosophers and thinkers of modern India. His popularity among the students was so significant that when he was leaving Mysore to join as a professor in Calcutta, a flower-decked carriage was pulled by his students all the way from Mysore University to Mysore railway station. Scholar. He taught at myriad universities around the world, including universities of Calcutta, University of Mysore, Harvard University, Manchester College, Oxford. And on this day, we tribute to the great teacher, great philosopher, and great president of this great country. So if you look at USA, Teachers' Day is observed for the full week of May. First full week of May as Teacher Appreciation Week. The United Kingdom celebrates Teachers' Day on October 5. So why do we celebrate Teachers' Day? It is not only an ornamental formal celebration. The objective of today's Teachers' Day celebration is that it represents a significant token of the awareness, understanding, and appreciation displayed for the vital contributions that teachers make to the national and community development. Teachers' Day provides a platform for us to demonstrate the value and importance we attach to the teaching community and to the contributions of teachers to national development. On this happy occasion, I salute the teachers of the Central University of Tamil Nadu, who are doing a commendable work. Today's event is an apt illustration of the importance attached to the teaching and learning process and the teacher's important position in the educational scenario. I would like to stress one important factor, that the quality teachers are essential for quality education. The Indian Education Commission, led by Dr. Kothari, the then UGC chairman, in its report, Monumental Education Commission report, in its very first line, has very aptly told, the destiny of our country is shaped by the teachers in their classrooms. So if the teachers are good, everything will be good, everything goes well in the country. So that way, quality teachers are very essential for quality education. And learning is very important, more important than teaching. And at the same time, that teaching is also essential contributing factor for effective learning. And that is why we give lot of importance for the well-being of the teacher, beginning with the recruitment of the teachers, training of the teachers, deployment of the teachers, career development of the teachers, welfare of the teachers, and retirement of the teachers. Beginning from recruitment of teachers to retirement of teachers. So unless we address teacher issues in a comprehensive manner, we may not achieve the desired goals of quality education in our country. So a teacher who is not properly trained, who is not properly deployed, who does not have the opportunities for career development, who is not provided with ongoing professional development, whose welfare is not taken care of, cannot be a committed professional who can bring about marked improvement in the learning of his students. So here, an untrained teacher, an unqualified teacher, an unmotivated teacher, an ineffective teacher becomes a liability, spoiling the institution and spoiling the country as well. So the attitude of the teacher, aptitude of the teacher, interest of the teacher, these three things are very, very critical. Attitude, aptitude, and interest. And teaching is not everybody's cup of tea. Teachers should have a passion for teaching, commitment for teaching. And all we know, passions die at the hands of wrong doctors. Buildings collapse at the hands of wrong engineers. The whole system of education gets spoiled at the hands of wrong teachers. Destroying any nation does not require atomic bombs. It can be done through lowering the quality of education and lowering the quality of teachers. This is an occasion to remind us how we are indebted to many inspiring, patient, passionate, committed teachers who were fortunate to encounter during our educational long journey. Without a committed teacher, without a devoted teacher, none of us here would reach our potential as of now. Research literature shows lot of research evidence that teacher quality is a very critical component of pupil performance. The quality of teaching is the most critical driver of quality in any educational system. Let me give you an example from one study in United States of America. An individual student who was taught for 3 consecutive years can make double the time more progress when he is taught by a top performing teacher rather than by a poorly performing teacher in the same institution, in the same building, with the same facilities, in the same grade, with the same background. So while all other factors remain the same, what made the difference in the achievement of the student, that critical difference is the performance of the teacher. So analysis in British studies also show remarkable improvement in pupils' performance when they were taught by quality teachers. So that way, great teaching does make a big significant difference in students' performance. Great teaching is an art as well as a science. It involves energy, empathy, authority, and resilience, detailed planning, self-improvement, continuous learning. A great teacher has the ability to read the classroom and understand the dynamics of classroom. And he should show classroom leadership, inspirational leadership, exciting and motivating pupils to help them achieve their full potential. Most important trait which is essential for the teachers is, I can say, twofold. Number one, the teachers should love the students. Number two, the teachers should love the subject. Love for students and love for knowledge. These two things are very, very essential. Crores and crores of money are invested in maintaining institutions of higher education. From the poor man's money, from the pauper's money, from the taxpayer's money, who did not enjoy this privilege, but willingly contributed to the younger generation to lead a better life through education. How are we going to repay the poor people? That is what is called accountability to the society. Our education, our teachers, we should make ourselves, rededicate ourselves with more sense of accountability to the society and commitment to the enhanced commitment to the society. Swami Vivekananda, in a letter to his friend in Chennai in 1894, very beautifully told about this accountability factor. I am quoting from Swami Vivekananda. So long as millions live in hunger, so long as millions live in ignorance, I hold every man a traitor who, having been educated at their expense, pays not the least heed to them. I would like to present certain mind-boggling facts about Indian social development. More than 300 million people live below global poverty standard. More than 200 million people in India go to bed without food, hungry every day. 400 million people are illiterate. 70% of Indian population have no access to good sanitation facilities. 30% of population do not have access to safe drinking water. 50% of urban population reside in slum areas. 40 million children of India are orphans. 20 million are street children. 15 million children work as child laborers, earning just 10 rupees per day, 16 hours working per day. About 46% of children below are suffering from undernutrition or malnutrition. One child dies every 6 seconds due to poverty and malnutrition. More than 7 lakh children die every year due to waterborne diseases. Around 2 million people die every year due to malaria, TB, and AIDS. India ranks very low among the countries in Human Development Index, and largest percentage of unemployed population is our educated youth. It is in this scenario, a 2015 UNESCO report said that in terms of absolute numbers, India with 28.7 crore illiterates is the country with largest number of adults without basic literacy skills in 2010-11 compared to 2000-2001 when it had 30.4 crore illiterates. I would like to quote the father of our nation, Mahatma Gandhiji. The soul of India lives in its villages, but the people living in rural areas continue to lag behind in lifelong education, healthcare, technological advancement, and socio-economic development. Access to affordable quality education is still a distant dream for 68.84% according to the census report of 2011. According to the National Sample Survey Organization, the GER, gross enrollment ratio in rural areas, is much below the national average, while in urban, it is more than twice that of rural locations. The education hubs in India are largely located in urban centers. As portrayed in the All India Survey on Higher Education 2010-11, 64% of universities and 52% of colleges are situated in urban locations. It trims down the opportunity of higher education for a large segment of rural population, posing the constraints of institutional reach in terms of time, transport, and expenses. It is in this context the Central University of Tamil Nadu, which is located in a rural area in a disadvantaged segment of population in a delta region, has a very crucial role to contribute for community development, rural development, and social development. The teachers of Central University of Tamil Nadu have a very crucial role in the construction of this local community and national development. And to overcome the challenge of rural backwardness, we, the stakeholders of CUTN, must build the partnership with other actors of social development, industries, etc., who share the goal of social justice and sustainability. On this happy occasion, I am very happy to announce that this Central University of Tamil Nadu, as the officiating Vice Chancellor, I have initiated a proposal for the award of Digital Teacher of the Year for the teachers of Central University of Tamil Nadu. And this Digital Teacher of the Year award will be instituted in order to sensitize the teachers about the potentials of innovative digital e-content materials and experiments in various disciplines, keeping in lines with the National Policy on Education 2020 and the national digital initiatives initiated by our Government of India, Ministry of Human Resource Development in 2017. And in addition to that, I have also proposed to create a distance education cell at the Central University of Tamil Nadu to ensure to provide quality education as an internal resource generation strategy to contribute to the enhancement of GER, gross enrollment ratio in higher education in this part of the country in the lines of new education policy. It will also facilitate students' enrollment in skill-based programs. And another important initiative I would like to propose is that due to the COVID-19 pandemic, there is a paradigm shift changing the face of higher education towards online mode of education. As per the recommendations of the National Mission on Education through Information and Communication Technology, NMEICT, National Digital Initiatives launched in 2017 and National Policy on Education 2020, it is proposed to establish a digital learning repository in the Central University of Tamil Nadu as a reservoir of quality digital learning materials for the perpetual access by all the students of not only the Central University of Tamil Nadu, but by all the institutions across the country and across the world. So all these initiatives, I have proposed to present it for approval in the ensuing Executive Council meeting, and I hope that it will be positively approved, after which these things will be activated in our Central University of Tamil Nadu. With these few words, I would like to conclude my presidential address by wishing all the teachers a very wonderful, joyful, and rewarding future. Teachers, you believe in yourselves, your potential, You have all the strength. You are an excellent teacher with lot of educational and experiential, lot of experiences, rich experiences, which you have brought to Central University of Tamil Nadu from various institutions. Now it is time to go boldly forward, be firm, be positive, be disciplined, and embrace your professional life with the social commitment. And I also would like to make use of this opportunity to heartily extend my very sincere welcome to our Chancellor, Professor Padmanabhan, who has been very gracious. Whenever we invite him, he never hesitates. He came for the inauguration of the national webinar on the national policy and education just last month. And again, yeah, he has come forward amidst his very busy schedules. It shows the academic involvement of our Chancellor in the developmental activities of the Central University of Tamil Nadu. And we are really very fortunate to have the Padmabhushan, a very iconic figure, a teacher of teachers, a scientist of scientists, as our Chancellor. And I wish you, sir, a very hearty welcome. And on behalf of the Central University of Tamil Nadu and on my own behalf, I extend our Chancellor a very hearty welcome. And I extend a very hearty welcome to our Vice Chancellor of the Central University of Kerala, Professor H. Venkateswaralu, who has joined the Central University of Kerala, who took charge 1 month back. And we know the busy schedules a new Vice Chancellor will be having the Central University. And when I contacted him, he has readily agreed, and he has also evinced a lot of interest in academic collaboration, because this is an era of collaboration rather than competition. We should help each other, support each other. I used to quote Bernard Shaw, if you give me an apple, if I give you an apple, we are left with one apple each. If you give me an idea, if I give you an idea, we are left with two ideas. So it is the time to come closer. Institutions should come together, collaborate with each other, support each other. And when we submit a proposal to UGC or MHRD, instead of unidisciplinary research proposal, if we submit a proposal with interdisciplinary and multidisciplinary concept, the chances of getting a grant are very bright. In the same way, when institutions come together and make a joint proposal to funding agencies, our chances of institutional development, funding, getting funding also will be very bright. And Central University of Kerala and Central University of Tamil Nadu have a lot of things in common to share. And that way, I take this opportunity to extend a very warm welcome to the Vice Chancellor of Central University of Kerala and our Vice Chancellor of Pondicherry University. Our good friend, Professor Gurmeet Singh, is also associated with us for a long time. He is an experienced Vice Chancellor, and Pondicherry University has a long history, long legacy, and great stalwarts like Professor Jnanam, Professor Venkata Subramanian, very big stalwarts, occupied the positions of Vice Chancellors in the Central University of Pondicherry. And that way, we have a lot of things, best practices to be learned from that university also. I take this opportunity to extend a very cordial welcome to the Vice Chancellor of the Central University of Pondicherry. Once again, I welcome each and every one of you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. You made us to understand our roles and responsibilities. Nicely, you mentioned, sir, we are living in the era of collaboration instead of looking others as competitors. We are blessed to have the blessings of a great teacher like you in this great celebration, sir. The first speaker of today is the first person of Central University of Tamil Nadu who is both a biochemist and biotechnologist. He is the former director of the Indian Institute of Science and currently serving as honorary professor in the Department of Biochemistry at IISc. His passion towards chemistry is unmatchable, and he gave up his engineering and joined in the Presidency College and started his journey as a learner of chemistry. He completed his master's in soil chemistry at Indian Agricultural Research Institute, New Delhi, and PhD in biochemistry from IISc Bangalore. He did enormous application-oriented research in his career. Notably, his group discovered the hemibiosynthetic pathway in the malarial parasite and showed it to be a drug target. His contribution towards vaccine development is remarkable, and he is the recipient of Shankishwara Bhatnagar Prize for Science and Technology in the year 1983, Padmashree in the year 1991, and Padma Bhushan in the year 2003. He is also an elected fellow of National Academy of Medical Sciences. CUTN is fortunate to have such an eminent person as Chancellor. May I humbly request our Honorable Chancellor Sir, the soft personality with the strong desire, Padma Bhushan, Professor G. Padmanabhan Sir, for his Teacher's Day address. Sir, please.
Thank you, and I hope you can hear me well. Dr. Kumaravel, distinguished Vice Chancellors, several teachers, and I hope there are some students also. It's indeed a great privilege for me to be participating in this Teachers' Day celebration, which had to be postponed, as told by Dr. Kumaravel, because of the sad demise of our former president, Dr. Pranab Mukherjee. I also want to congratulate Dr. Kumaravel for all that he's trying to do at this university. And he sent me a message recently that the CUTN will be starting a community radio station. It's just, in my opinion, is an example of the dynamism with which he is moving ahead, and I wish him well. The CUTN represents to me a phenomenal story. I read that it had one department and 8 students in 2009. And today, my numbers may be wrong, they have 27 departments and perhaps more than 2,100 students. As Dr. Kumaravel said, in the rice belt of Tamil Nadu, and the representing the deep culture of Chola dynasty, an institution that is situated in the village or a rural environment is also trying its best to become an all India institution, all India in character. This is something remarkable for a university to have grown phenomenally and also to become an all India in character. I read somewhere it's about 45% they are students from outside the state. This is something remarkable in my opinion. But there are challenges in my opinion, because you have to cater to the local community. Because as Dr. Kumaravel also said, this is a rural university, rural students who have aspirations. And we normally, many times, wrongly estimate capabilities of rural students. They may be having language problem, but in terms of brain power, many times we have found at the institute interviews much better than metro students. The metro students speak very fluent English, but what we do at the Institute of Science, when we admit students, we talk to them in their vernacular language if they cannot speak English very well. But then you find their understanding of the subject is far better than a metro student. So we should not underestimate the rural students. But it's a challenge, because education is not a priority, honestly. Because they're all agriculture in background and they would like to go back to the field. Or if they're not, their parents will force them. Therefore, we need to bring them to this task. At the same time, there is no compromise on being the best institution. There is no compromise in your quality of research. I am a researcher all along, and therefore I do believe that, there is no compromise on the quality of R&D which you do, because I believe it's a good research that helps you good teaching. I do not think the two can be dissociated. The two are very, very closely linked, because I told last time, I was a bit surprised when the new education policy in the beginning said there will be teaching university, there will be a research university. I said, what is this? Anyway, finally, they have changed the whole thing. Anyway, it's a one single multidisciplinary university. And I think the CUT has already is a multidisciplinary university. So when I say research, it is not necessarily confined to physical sciences or natural sciences. Social sciences, humanities, they do become very, very important these days, especially because of the context today. Country or the whole globe is demanding. Science is okay, research is okay, publications are okay. What has the country benefited? What has the globe benefited? Therefore, translation is the mantra today, and you know, everyone talks about translation. Have you been able to translate your research? Therefore, the kind of education we need to do, we need to give today, is just not enough to do classroom or online, or an education that gives you ideas, but ideas that can be translated. And emphasize that, you know, the importance of translation. I remember years ago, when I was going up, you know, if somebody does collaboration with the industry, it will be looked down upon. Now the whole scenario is changed. After all, you see in industry, our own equivalents, you know, they are also PhDs, many of them, except they, at some point of time, they chose to start an industry, especially biotech industry, the field which I'm familiar with. So you see, this is the entire scenario is changing. Therefore, the challenges, in my opinion, are for a university like CUTN, while you have to serve the local community, that is especially the rural community, you have also to be an All India Institute. You have also to be one of the best institutes. It is not an easy challenge, but I think this is what we all look for, and we need to strive to achieve the same. Now, I just, you know, a few minutes, I mean, maybe 3-4 minutes I will take. You know, you have to talk about teaching. With all the scenario that has totally changed, everyone talks about online teaching, and there are so many digital methods of teaching. But ultimately, I must tell you, there is nothing like a personal interaction. There is nothing like having communities together. Communities teaching, communities learning together. I find in the United States, they have finally combined these two. There are some courses which are online. There are some courses where the student is physically present. Because they learn, it is not just the classroom teaching. There are so many things which you learn, as you know, I don't have to tell you. When you interact with your own colleagues, when you interact with your teachers, when you interact with your seniors, juniors, and so on. Therefore, I really feel the challenge is to combine how to give online at the same time. Hopefully this COVID will, you know, will weaken over a period of time. But even so, Tamil Nadu in particular, I find has liberalized almost everything. Therefore, I do believe we should also have physical teaching, you know, that has also been done. How safely it has to be done, how to follow the precautions. These are all challenges which one has to undergo. One point I want to, because there are other speakers, so I don't want to take very much time. I cannot but mention about this COVID. You know, this is in my own life, I have not seen such a pandemic. I only heard of Spanish flu, which is perhaps bigger. And I hope we will not be reaching there. This pandemic will close down. But if we carefully look, maybe I am old-fashioned. If you carefully look, this is a way by which I feel nature, if you don't believe in God, puts a balance. We have been having a roller coaster ride. Countries, have lost their moorings. You know, anything is permissible. The society has become totally permissible. Anything can be done. No questions asked. You know, somebody goes to a jail, somebody comes out of the jail, it is celebrated, you know. So it's all right. Freedom fighters went to the jail, but not, you know, thugs and others who go to the jail. When they come out, you celebrate their release or something. So what I'm trying to just give an example, you know, our value, sense of value seem to have changed over a period of time. And this has happened. And definitely I believe that Bharat, India, definitely is the home of culture, home of spiritual values. What I'm trying to tell, message, pass the message, the students, while they talk about science, you know, I'm a hardcore researcher all along, but I believe strongly in spirituality. That means, you know, you owe sacrifice. A sacrifice is very, very important for this. Teachers in particular, for example, teachers are always compared to a ladder. Ladder allows others to climb. The ladder doesn't move anywhere. The ladder stays there. So therefore, there has to be a spirit of sacrifice. There has to be a spirit of give. You know, loga samasta sukino bhavantu. You know, this is, you know, what our culture starts. And it's extraordinarily important that we remember our sense of values in this country. This country has had a great tradition. And I'm sure students are aware, teachers are aware. And the tradition also needs to be taught along with most modern science. There is no compromise on the quality of science you should do. There should be no quality on this compromise on the quality of research which you do. You publish papers, translate, but the community should benefit. Whether it is agriculture, whether it is engineering, whether it is basic science, or whether it is biotechnology, whatever. I think this is where, you know, the message I want to give, along with hardcore teaching, along with hardcore science, teach them the cultural values. Teach them the spiritual values of this country, for which I do believe, you know, this country is still has some spiritual power in it, you know, so that it will be able to give messages for the whole welfare of the whole welfare of the whole globe. And I wish this meeting very well, and I think there are eminent speakers to be followed, and I look forward to hearing all of you. Once again, congratulate all of you, and especially Dr. Kumaravel, for arranging this kind of a meeting. Thank you so much. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Your words are motivating us to go for more number of quality publications and show our concern more towards the society. Teachers are like ladders, but you are an exemption. You served as a lift. You not only reach greater heights, and you also make people, those who are worked under you, those who have followed you, to reach greater heights, sir. Thank you so much, sir. May I request our Honorable Vice Chancellor appreciating Professor Karthava Kumaravel, sir, to formally thank our Chancellor, sir. Please, sir.
Sir, I am very much thankful to you for your very kind words, words of wisdom, which are very relevant, very significant, very inspiring also. And Chancellor has very rightly pointed out in the beginning of his observations the unique features of the Central University of Tamil Nadu in the context of the rural disadvantaged location. And he has also pointed out the challenges of a university like the Central University of Tamil Nadu located at a disadvantaged rural segment of the population. And we are very fortunate to have an understanding chancellor who understands the nuts and bolts of higher education and the intricacies of the Central University of Tamil Nadu. And our chancellor has also rightly pointed about the gap between research and development. He has very rightly pointed out that research should lead to development. It should not stop with theorization. It should go beyond theory, and it should contribute to development, and that way it is a very valid observation made by him. And third important observation made by our chancellor is that there is nothing like a personal interaction. Yes, sir, we agree that technology can supplement a teacher. Technology cannot supplant a teacher. It is very true. And I used to say, a lady even with the technological gadgets like mixer, grinder, refrigerator, will not be able to prepare a tasty food at all. Whereas a country lady without mixie, without a gas stove, without a grinder, without these technological gadgets, the country lady just with firewood and clay pot may be able to prepare a very tasty food. So it is the expertise of the teacher, which is very important. And technology is there to empower the teacher, to help the teacher. A teacher should treat technology as a tool of empowerment. Or I can put it in different words. Technology is a good servant, as long as it is a servant. And we should not allow technology to be a bad master. And that way, that is a very valid observation made by our chancellor. And fourth important observation is the spiritual qualities needed for a teacher. Affective qualities, human qualities, values of a teacher, which are very, very important. We are always concerned about the qualifications of the teachers. In teacher recruitment, we have evidences of the cognitive manifestations of a teacher in terms of grade 55%, NET SLET examination pass, PhD, all these things, they are all evidences of his cognitive achievement. But we are to have evidences of his affective qualities also, qualities of values. Even in this technological era, the Gurukula system of education, the Gurukula period of Indian education is considered still as the golden period in the history of education. Our ancient universities, Takshashila University, Nalanda University, Ujjain University, Kanji University, they were all very glorious institutions. The Chinese scholar Yuan Shuang, he came all along the way from China to receive higher education in India simply for the quality of higher education we had. So golden period was those days when we laid emphasis on the values of a teacher. And on those days, even in Ramayana, Rama was asked, he was known not by his father, but by his teacher. So they will not ask, who is your father? Who is your teacher? So that way, it is a very important observation made by our chancellor. Sir, we are very much inspired, motivated, and encouraged. And that way, we have a very right person to speak about a right topic on the right occasion to begin the day. And we are very much thankful, grateful to our chancellor for his very inspiring words and for his precious time. I thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kumarwell. Thank you. Right. Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Listening to leaders is natural. Every one of us will do. Listening and responding to our subordinates is an extraordinary behavior and difficult to exercise. We are fortunate to be with us today, such a wonderful personality who created a benchmark for that. He cares more for the welfare and emotional well-being of people. His action plan of meeting the faculty members once in 3 months in open floor and for open discussion for all the issues attracts all and appreciated by many. Pondicherry University is experiencing and we are witnessing your servant leadership style, sir. Professor Singh began his academic career as a lecturer in the Department of Chemistry, University of Delhi in 1976. And he is an internationally reputed expert in the field of corrosion science and smart materials. He has held the position of proctor, head of the department, member of executive council, and numerous other administrative positions in University of Delhi. He was a visiting scientist to Hungary and Japan and has been on academic assignments to Germany, Italy, Australia, Singapore, Korea, Thailand, and Kenya. He is also currently a visiting professor at Japan Advanced Institute of Science and Technology. He is a very inspiring teacher and mentor and a very good researcher. He is the recipient of the Meritorious Contribution Award, the Annapurna Award, membership of the Royal Society of Chemistry London, and fellowship of SAIT and the Electrochemical Society of India. On behalf of Central University of Tamil Nadu, we humbly invite Honorable Vice Chancellor Professor Gurmit Singh for his Teacher's Day address. Sir, please.
Thank you very much for your kind words about me. Very respected the Chancellor of Tamil Nadu Central University, Professor Padmanabhan, Professor Kumaravel, the present person who's heading this university, and Professor Venkateshwar Varlu, the newly appointed Vice Chancellor of Kerala University, and all other faculty members, students, researchers who are present on this wonderful occasion of Teachers' Day. In fact, when we look at the calendar these days, you have all kinds of days. Friendship Day, Father's Day, Brother's Day, Food Day, all you name a thing, it'll be there. So when it comes to Teachers' Day, we'll really feel very privileged that, well, in society, teachers are recognized, which in my opinion is the most important single factor which should be highlighted for all. Well, Professor Padmanabhan may not remember, but then I would like to remind him. He came to our university, University of Delhi, way back in 2008 or 9 as a convener of the NAC team. That was the time I was the proctor of the university and heading the chemistry department. So I had the privilege of interacting with him, but I don't think he would be remembering that.
No, I remember, Dr. Singh, I remember.
Professor Pental was the vice chancellor. And that was the time, 3-4 days we interacted with you, which was very fruitful, let me tell you. See, Teachers' Day is a very happy occasion for all of us. We celebrate. We celebrate across all universities, all colleges, even the remotest part. Also, schools will be celebrating. But let me tell you, rarely anybody would have conveyed to our community that we do celebrate this, but do we ever think about what our responsibilities are? I'm of the opinion that if somebody has to do very well, there has to be, in the universities particularly, there has to be a blend of excellence in teaching and research. What unfortunately I'm noticing, the trend amongst the youngsters when we discuss and deliberate with them on many academic and other issues, their inclination is more towards research. They will say, well, we have to publish. Teaching, who cares? Who bothers? And when we are ultimately promoted, they ask us the first question, how many publications you have? Rather than asking how many quality publications you have. That's a little unfortunate. But then that is the thing which is percolating to our youngsters, that they are more inclined to research, and they are taking teaching to a secondary level or a subsidiary level, which in my opinion, is very unfortunate development. We, during our career as a student, all over, initially at St. Stephen's, then at University of Delhi, we had some remarkable teachers, let me tell you, and had they not been there, I very much doubt we would have been where we are. We owe it a great debt of gratitude to all of them, that they showed us the way what should be done in teaching. And if somebody is a good teacher, everything else comes in. Ethics will come, value one will learn, the discipline one will come, sense of time management will come. And obviously one would be a good researcher also, because what one requires in one's life is a sense of discipline, a sense of dedication, sense of sincerity. When you have this, you automatically will be sincerely working for your research career as well. On the other side, if somebody is a good researcher and you don't pay attention to teaching, there are many acumens in your life which you will be missing out, and you will find that it will not take you very far. So I would tend to say that if somebody has been a good researcher but zero in teaching, one would not go very far. It has to be a blend of two. And in the unfortunate time of pandemic, of course, I salute our IT developers that they have taken on online in a big way, and then we haven't felt the shortcomings which otherwise we would have noticed, that we have taken teaching, everything, meetings, webinars in a big way because of this technological development. We have not been left wanting in terms of this. But I have always had a very firm opinion. My firm view is, which Padmanabhan also has expressed, that nothing can replace eye-to-eye contact while teaching. At least I have felt all through the teaching career. In my own department, I used to take very difficult subjects in my very difficult topics in my subject, group theory and reaction mechanism, quantum mechanics, from where people literally run away, let me tell you. But then this eye-to-eye contact, when you do, nothing can replace this. But in the kind of time we are in, I feel it's the need of the hour, and we have adopted it very well. But ultimately, it has to be a blend of both, because when you're teaching in the class, sometimes, well, this technology does help you when you have to give a lot of data, a lot of complicated diagrams. That is where you need to supplement this. It should not be totally, one shouldn't be totally dependent on this. If somebody is confident, somebody knows, I think the chalk and blackboard cannot be replaced in a teacher's life. And then once you are doing very well, you will find everything else will come your way. I mean, I will remind you, you know, invariably people say teachers are very dry people. They have no sense of humor. They don't live their life very well. I beg to differ. Let me tell you, you look at any great teacher, they will have all these wonderful qualities. And this Teacher's Day is celebrated to honor our great philosopher president, Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan sir. You know, he was a remarkable teacher, let me tell you. Remarkable teacher, I'm emphasizing. And when he became president, I mean, he had a wonderful sense of humor also. The way his humor will come so instantaneously, it is something to be reading about. Then only you will realize the greatness of this great teacher. I remember a couple of things which I read a few days back about him. He was a president, even he went to the airport to receive the king of Greece. And when came and he was greeting, he says, you are the first king who has been invited to our country. So welcome, you are the first king who has been invited to our country. And the last one, Alexander the Great, came uninvited. So, you know, this is the way instantaneously one comes up. Winston Churchill was, he gave a tea party in his honor. And he says, Mr. President, do you know, when he was mixing sugar in that cup of tea, he says, Mr. President, do you know, sugar has this letter S, and this is the only letter, only word in English where the pronunciation of S is carried out as ch, sh, sugar. Then instantaneously, Dr. Radhakrishnan replied, are you sure? So this is instantaneous humor, and it will come when you have this quality of a great teacher behind you. Sure, are you sure? So he reminded that, well, what you're telling is not correct. Gandhiji told him, let's stop drinking milk, because it is the essence of human flesh. So why have beef? He said, Mahatma, if you take it that way, then we all have taken our mother's milk, then we can be classified as cannibals also. Same, without waiting for a second, the reply would come. In one of the dinners Mr. Churchill hosted, Dr. Radhakrishnan went, washed his hands, and started eating with his hands, true to our Indian tradition. And when he was enjoying his meals, they were feeling a little uneasy, and they said, won't it be good if you use fork and knife? It'll be more hygienic. Instantaneously, Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan replied that, look, nobody can use my hands to eat. My hands will be used by me only. So I think nothing can be more hygienic than that. And your fork and spoon, you can guess. So such was the level of confidence which he showed and indicated. And that's what will come out from a person who has had the tremendous sense of confidence and command over the subject. Subject was philosophy, you know it. But then the way he developed into this and rose to this great height, I think it is a lesson for all of us. And the lesson we learned on this great day is that we are doing very well in our researches, but then let's be good teachers also. I think when you start communicating and start teaching in the most sincere manner, you will be conveying the right message to the students, and you will ultimately realize that these are the very people who would be ultimately rising to serve their community in the best possible manner. The importance of this, in my opinion, cannot be undermined. Dr. Kumarvel talked about few things which were, you might find a little depressing, but then let me tell you, it is not all that bad. Our country has done wonderfully well. Compare our country with any other country which would have had the kind of problems that we have faced in the last 70 years. Our population explosion, our floods, our food grain shortage, all kinds of shortages. But the way we have come up, I will give you in half a minute, you look at the data of what we were, food grain production we had in 65, 55, 65, 75, 85. Look at the graph and what, how well we have done. Despite our fields getting shrunk, our the mouths to be fed having increased enormously, how well we have done, it is for you to analyze. I will not give you the data and waste your time. Everybody will know. But yes, what we need is the nutritional value of the food we need to add. Of course, and our biotechnologists, which Professor Nabhan has said, are doing very well. Look at the milk production. Number of cattle gone down drastically. Grazing fields have gone down drastically. But the way George Kurian took this upon himself and the kind of direction which was given, we are now the largest producer in the world. Maximum milk is produced in India. And the great honor was when the American Dairy Association invited these people from Anand to come and manage our show. I don't know how many of you have visited these dairies there. They will have 30,000 cows in one particular dairy, their own park generations, own grazing field. But as compared to the way we do it, despite all that, the way we have come up, it is remarkable. Look at our space program, look at our educational program, look at the way we are now developing into infrastructure. We didn't do it earlier because our priorities were not that. So we are doing very well, let me tell you. All that we need is, I am telling my young friends, young teachers who are getting into this service, all that we need is to put in our best in our profession, that is teaching and research. If we do it with utmost sincerity, I don't see our country will be the one which will be left behind in any respect as compared to any other country. You look at IT, you look at all other sectors, medical sectors, the way we have come up, it is remarkable. It is something we need to be proud of, that we are doing very well and we have the potential to go miles and miles if we keep our confidence level at what we need to have it. So therefore, I urge all my young friends who are listening to me that please take up your teaching extremely seriously, so that when you're teaching a class of 40, all 40 students should say, well, we really enjoyed this lecture. We really have learned what is it. We will never forget this. That is the thing which one should come out after the class. And let me tell you, for your own individual skill, when you will take a good, motivating, properly taught lecture, properly delivered lecture, I'll say, the kind of immense satisfaction that you will have, let me tell you, you do it and feel where it takes you. So I urge all of you to celebrate this teaching day, this teacher's day rather, in the right spirit by doing our own work with the utmost sincerity. That should be the essence for all of us. And if we do that, I don't see any reason why a university like Tamil Nadu University, Central University, which is in the rural background, will not become amongst one of the best and will not serve the community the way it deserves to be doing this. That was the aim with which it was established. So I wish the university all the very best and wish all the administrators of the university wonderfully well. And Professor Padmanabhan, who is the chancellor, who himself has been a very notable biotechnologist, I'm sure he, along with the other administrators, would give a right direction to this particular university. It is in for a very good time with such stalwarts leading this. Dr. Kumarvel has already enlisted a lot of initiatives. So I wish them all the very best. And let me tell you, I am in Pondicherry. It's a place which is full of spirituality, full of positivity. The moment you enter in the arena of Pondicherry, some kind of a positivity sets in. So spirituality and ethics also are equally important. They also cannot be undermined. If you have a blend of these in your life, I think you will have no occasion to look back. And I will say then, for all the youngsters, sky will not be the limit. Thank you so very much for inviting me. And I wish the webinar and the occasion which we are celebrating, that is Teachers' Day, all the very best. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. You have clearly mentioned the right blend of responsibility of the teachers towards teaching, research, and also towards the society. Let me welcome our Honorable Vice Chancellor, appreciating Professor Kadpaha Kumaravel, sir, to propose a vote of thanks for our Honorable Vice Chancellor of Pondicherry University.
Professor Gurmeet Singh, sir, you have delivered a very wonderful speech. We are very much thankful to you. And it is the fourth meeting I share with Professor Gurmeet Singh. First one in the Pandit Madan Mohan Malaviya program at Pondicherry University. The second meeting in Sri Lanka, just closely before the COVID-19 pandemic in February 2nd week. When we returned from Poland to India, the pandemic started. It was such a critical period. We shared the dais in the National Institute of Education, Colombo, where Professor Gurmeet Singh spoke very effectively on the need for psychology in schools. Last week, we joined in the UGC HRDC, Human Resource Development Center, online inauguration program. And now again, I have the pleasure of joining with him and listening to his thoughtful observations. The hallmark of Professor Gurmeet Singh's presentation is that he will deliver very serious, very significant observations in a very casual and very friendly manner. He is loved by one and all in Pondicherry University. And he also had scholarly citations in his speech from Alexander the Great, Winston Churchill, in a very relevant way. And he has also quoted from the life of Dr. Radhakrishnan, how his confidence and command over the subject was respected by one and all. Professor Gurmeet Singh has also given a note of optimism and gave a positive note that we need not be skeptical about the data of Indian reality. And it is the time that we should face to the occasion. So his presentation has been in a very lucid, palpable language, down-to-earth, friendly manner. And he is an accessible vice chancellor. And in the same way, his speeches are also very accessible, very intelligible, not only to the professors, but also to the students as well. So once again, sir, I thank you very much for sparing your very precious time amidst your very busy schedules, for the benefit of the CUTN stakeholders, for the benefit of the faculty members, scholars, students, and the audience. I once again thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sirs. Professor H. Vengadeshwaralu is a well-known professor of commerce. He has 30 years of service and 20 years as professor in Osmania University. Being an expert in marketing management, he stands as a mentor for many corporates. He extended his service under various capacities as coordinator, DRS2, UGC SAP, principal, executive vice president for Indian Commerce Association, dean, head, and chairperson of various committees. More than a professor, a researcher, Professor Vengadeshwaralu is a notable trainer for industries. As a trainer, he is imparted training to various industries, and to name a few, he has given training to senior marketing executives at IPE Hyderabad, marketing directors, Northeastern Council, Government of India, Export Marketing for Engineering Products, SISI Government of India, and so on. He authored 5 books in the field of management and commerce, namely Marketing Management in Public Enterprises, Marketing Management, Business Communication and Report Writing, Marketing, and Emerging Trends in Banking. We have such a renowned professor of commerce is with us today for the next address. May I request Professor H. Vengeshwarulu, sir, the Vice Chancellor of Central University of Kerala, for his Teacher's Day address, please.
Yeah, thank you very much, madam. Good afternoon to all the ladies and gentlemen who are present here. A very auspicious day. I am fortunate to be with all the great personalities who are present here. Professor Padmanabhan, I heard about him when I was in Usmania University, and now I have heard him. It's very enlightening, sir. It's really rewarding. It is educating. The officiating vice chancellor and very recently Gurmeet Singh, sir. It's nice that we are talking about and we are thinking about the teacher. We are reminded of his role and what he has been doing to the society. By and large, many things have already been said by the earlier speakers. I would say to start at the core of the society. The core of the society, take say 500 years back, take 1,000 years back. It has been evolving. The society has been evolving. The society has learned geographically at places. Today, hardly maybe 500 years old, society is dominating the world. Now, how is it possible? Speaking from the economics angle, we have categorized the societies into developed nation, developing nation. So they we are seeing the distinct differences in the societies that have evolved over a period of time. Now, can we identify what is the source of the difference between one society and the other society? I'm sure the difference is the processes, differences in knowledge, knowledge creation and knowledge dissemination. A society which has been able to capture and give primary importance only to education has progressed faster and in all spheres of life. So that's, you know, very, very important point what we have to understand, what I feel. And the knowledge is the propriety of only a teacher, has been the propriety of a teacher. Or maybe the knowledge, you know, we understand that we all take our lives, the life of a country you take. You are talking about Dr. Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. Why Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan ji? He has influenced the country and the whole world with his knowledge. So the main pull-up is here, the knowledge which is held by, the knowledge which is spread by a teacher. Therefore, I find the development of a nation is received by the teacher in the beginning. You know, he is a facilitator. Otherwise, the nations cannot survive. I fully agree with Gurmeet Ji that we have done distinct achievements. All the distinct achievements have come through the different institutions facilitated by the government across the time. Science and technology, we are better. Maybe in other fields, we are not but better. So all these things, they have been definitely on account of the participation of the teacher in the societal committees. One, I would actually like to start. Yesterday, I was listening to the Honorable Education Minister. We are talking about the National Education Policy. Now, it is a great leverage. It's a great hand which is given to a teacher in India today. What is the government? What is the idea before the government? The Honorable Education Minister said three things. To reform. So a teacher has a role to reform. It begins at the age of 3 years when we go to a school as blank, as plain, where our cognition level is almost zero. So that's where itself the informative value enters the mind of a student, and it goes on, it grows on that. Form, then transform and perform. These are the three objectives of the education policy. The objectives are to be accomplished only with the help of a teacher. I'm sure all of our educational system, with the help of new educational policy, will take the help of the educational policy and try to develop all these three things and try to fulfill the aspirations of the youth that are coming into the society today. So there are the I would also say one more point. The role of a teacher today in 2020 compared to 2010 is very challenging and is very intriguing. That is, there are many aspirations which are unbelievable, which are unfathomable. Also, there are confusions. And a student who is coming as an input to the classroom is coming absolutely information savvy. Today we talk about a 2-year child, you know, can operate a smartphone, and she listens to a rhyme, the rhyme that she wants to listen. That is the kind of technology that has already come into many parts of the country, may not be available in the rural side of the country. But I would really agree with Padmanabhan ji, and I would like to stand there that, you know, the value system, he said, being a scientist, he talked about ethics. Being a scientist, he talked about values. And we learned, I think we used two words we have to use today. Whatever we learned in our commerce department of Usmania University, we learned 1 minute also is very, very important. We should not go to the class. We were not allowed to go to the class by 1 minute. Sir, it's only 1 minute. No, 1 minute. You should be on time. That is the sense of value, the values that we learn. Yesterday, somebody asked from Indian Express, so why do you need attendance? Yes, attendance is needed to instill some kind of system into the body and mind of a student when he goes out of the portals. That is, some systems are to be learned in the portals of educational institutions. The systems are to be governed by the teachers. So in the end, I will say some 2 or 3 points about how these days we are talking about teacher is a learning mediator. In the midst of technology, probably physical, but along with the physical contact also, a teacher has to be a learning mediator. And then we are talking about a last 15 days or so, I've been thinking about what is the role of a teacher? First, I say the role of a teacher is to understand the setting in which a student is born into the society. A student, particularly, let us say, who is coming into intermediate first year class 11, or let us say, into a BA program, is coming with some kind of background. Now, a teacher maybe has to begin his kind of input with the understanding of the backgrounds of a student, then he can be giving a total personality training, mentoring to the teaching. So I believe that teaching is not just for knowledge sake, but teaching is for making a total human being, the human being as directed by a teacher, as directed by a system, as given in the ethos and culture of a nation. So therefore, I would say the teacher is a thought facilitator since the beginning. That is, young age, even to a postgraduate, or even at this time of research, that is about 24, 25 years, all along these 20, 21 years, teacher is a thought facilitator. Thoughts provoke, thoughts encourage, thoughts discourage, and definitely thoughts alone will make a person what he is, what he can be, what he should be. So the kind of thought-making process, thought facilitation is started by a teacher and is really built into the kind of system what a person is likely to have all through his 15 to 20 years of learning. So I feel that fundamentally facilitators, creators, and nations are built by the teachers. Definitely, I consider them as the architects and the builders of the nation. And I'm sure, I'm confident that the National Education Policy 2020 rolled out to is being discussed in all the universities, and I'm sure universities are gearing up for the implementation where we have digitalization, particularly, as I fully agree with Padmanabhan sir, that these two cannot be independent, teaching and research. You know, I do my research, I take inputs from the research, I take those into the classroom, and from classroom some ideas are emanated, I'll go back to do research and then do some kind of survey and then take the input. So it is an interdependent process. Teaching and the research is an interdependent process. We cannot separate them. Research, less of teaching, more of teaching, less of research, but they cannot be disassociated, as sir has talked about. And the multidisciplinary approach, what it is emerging now, probably will help all of us so that we are not in our watertight compartments. You know, a science person will learn a bit of arts, an arts person will also learn a bit of computers, a bit of music. You know, this kind of a multidisciplinary approach will make, because all of us, we are now committed. We need to have a conviction that we want to develop the society. The societies, I started that we have evolved. As a society, now it is the stage for us to evolve a little more brighter, a little more sophisticated, a little more stronger. So the evolution of a society into a strong, prosperous society is possible through only a better education system. The implementer of education system or education policy is only the teacher. So therefore, there is a huge responsibility on the minds and also in the hearts of all the teachers of the country. And I'm really happy that the Central University of Tamil Nadu has thought of a wonderful program associating all senior teachers, the deans, students. I visited the Central University of Tamil Nadu about 2 years back, 2 or 3 years back. It was really surprising. As our chancellors have said, I reached around 1 a.m. I started in Hyderabad in the afternoon. I went to Chennai. Then Chennai, I took a flight to Kochi, I think. Kochi, then again my car, another 3 or 4 hours. My God, I would have rejected or so. But I reached and then I wondered that they are here, Central University. My God. And I moved into the Tiruvarur or some place nearby. I moved into the town. But it's you know, fascinating also. The teachers I interacted there, I met the registrar and vice versa. It's fascinating because the higher education, quality of education has entered the portals of rural areas of Tamil Nadu. Same is the case with me here, Kasargod. Now, Kasargod is a rural area. So I'm telling all my Kasargod people that as a central university, I'm telling all my teachers, last say 15 days, I have not done anything except the job of meeting a teacher. To me, as the head of the institution, the first priority is the only. So I'm telling all the teachers that we have to be connected to the whole society. So the society cannot be progressed without teacher connecting to the society. This is my strong feeling. With this, I once again congratulate, and Professor Kumar Velu was talking to me 2-3 times, and actually I have to say that I cancelled one program. The other teachers were waiting. I said tomorrow there was a program for me from 12 to 1. But anyway, it was very interesting to listen to Professor Padmanabhan, Professor Gurmeet, and Professor Kumar Velu himself. He has given a very wonderful, comprehensive thoughts on Teacher's Day, and also the role of universities. I'm happy to be here. Probably I'll be meeting personally all of you, Gurmeet ji. I think we have some common friends, one or two common friends, and I have friends in Pondicherry University also. Like Malavika is my colleague in Commerce Department. I came to Pondicherry and I stayed in your guest house for about 10 days, about 6 or 7 days before when we organized All India Commerce Conference. We organized there. Tarun was there in Pondicherry University. So maybe we'll be meeting physically. Let us all hope for
this. You are most welcome. It will be a pleasure to have you.
Pandemic. Kerala also is a wonderful place. I'll be creating some kind of opportunity for all the vice chancellors to come to Kerala. Once the COVID is gone, we'll have a nice program of interaction and exchange. That's what I wrote to all the 40 plus universities to give some one or two ideas, you know, which could be, you know, emulated, which could be taken to, as our friend has talked about. These are the days of collaboration. You know, these are the days of collaboration. As you know, we collaborate, we grow stronger as central universities. Let us define, redefine, tune, retune, you know, model, remodel, this kind of a thing. You know, it is a continuous process, and then we'll be able to do better service to the society. Thank you very much, Professor Kumar Velu, for this, giving me this wonderful opportunity talking to all of the people, all faculty members of Central University of Kerala. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir.
You clearly mentioned the role of a teacher is not only imparting knowledge but also to act as a facilitator. Let me invite the captain of Central University of Tamil Nadu, our honorable vice chancellor officiating, Professor Karpaga Kumaravel sir, for his words, please.
Professor Vengadeshwar sir, we are very much thankful to you for your brilliant address in the Teachers' Day celebration. Vice Chancellor from God's own country, Kerala, and the whole country is all praise for how this God's own country, Kerala, has very successfully tackled the COVID-19 pandemic. So it is a very successful state, and like that, we have a very successful, promising Vice Chancellor. We will definitely take the Central University of Kerala to new heights, and I am sure under your leadership, the university will grow further from strength to strength, and will be happy to extend all our support, all our cooperation. We will be with you in all your endeavors. And Professor Vengadeshwarlu, the Vice Chancellor, has very rightly started his session with an emphasis on social roles of the teacher. He made a very significant observation on what makes a difference between one society to another society. It is in terms of knowledge generation and knowledge dissemination. This is exactly what is expected from every university. Universities and higher education institutions are expected to do these two functions, generation of knowledge and dissemination of knowledge. And we are very happy that Professor Vengadeshwarlu has made a very relevant observation in his address. And he has also pointed out how the development of a nation will be possible only by a teacher. And he has quoted from the new National Policy on Education 2020, which is a great leverage for quality education. And he has also mentioned about value system and the need for ethical standards required for a teacher, endorsing the observations of our chancellor. And he has pointed out the role of a teacher as a learning mediator in this technological environment. And he has pointed out how a teacher has to be a learner. As Rabindranath Tagore has very rightly pointed out, a lamp cannot light another lamp unless it continues to burn. A teacher cannot teach other students unless he or she continues to learn. A teacher has to be a perennial learner. So that way, we are very happy that we have the Vice Chancellor from Central University of Kerala. And we have many things common between Central University of Kerala and Central University of Tamil Nadu. Both these universities were started in the same year. And we are sharing many common problems. And both the universities are located in rural area, in a far-flung area. So that way, a shared understanding and a shared collaboration between these universities will go a long way for the mutual benefit and a mutual development of these universities. I take this opportunity to extend an invitation to him to visit our university in person after this COVID-19 critical phase. So I once again thank you, sir, on behalf of the Central University of Tamil Nadu and on my own behalf for gracing this occasion with your very valuable inputs. Thank you once again. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Professor Jayashankar, who's accepted to be with us today, who is not only a successful administrator, but also an instrumental who produced more successful administrators in academics as well as industries. As tested with COVID positive, he could not able to join with us. Let us all pray for his speedy recovery. To pay our gratitude to all the eminent personalities, those who shared their valuable times, and those who shared their care and concern towards the society with us today, let me invite Professor Srinivasan sir, Professor and Head, Department of Education and Technology, Central University of Tamil Nadu, for his words.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's time for giving thanks to all. I first thank our Chancellor. It is said that teacher gives knowledge and Guru makes you wise. Our Chancellor is Guru for us. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your thought-provoking speech. On behalf of our VC, officers, faculty, staff, students of CUTN, we thank you, sir. Next, I thank our Vice-Chancellor CUTN. Being a teacher educator himself, he is fond of organizing Teachers' Day every year. This year also is made a memorable day for us by inviting Vice-Chancellors on this day. It is each said that education is not filling of a park, it is lighting of a fire. Your speech made a fire on us, sir. You also spoke about quality education, quality teaching, and quality teachers. We thank you, sir, for initiating awards and also have a collaboration with other institutions. Next, I would like to thank to Vice Chancellor Pondicherry University, Anatole France told that 9/10 of education is encouragement. Your words are encouragement to us, sir, and your speech was peppered with many humors of former President Sarvepalli Radhakrishnan. We thank you, sir. Finally, I would like to thank to Vice Chancellor Central University of Kerala. It is said that a good teacher is like a candle. It consumes itself to give way for others. Your speech also like that, sir. It gives a way for us to remove hurdles in our paths. You have also quoted inform, transform and perform, a quote by our Minister of Education yesterday. Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining us. I thank all officers, faculty members, research scholars, students who joined us and for patient listening. Thank you very much. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Let us raise for national anthem.
Thank you.